to be doing cartwheels, praising God. The way I'm going up and down, morning till night, every day. You know, hallelujah. Come on, join me and give a shout. Hallelujah. Testimony services go. People will just come out and start testifying, and you keep shouting, and before you know it, I don't know if you can sense the heat of the Holy Ghost is rising, and before long, miracles just break out, because the people of God humble themselves to praise God beyond their mind. Glory to God. Lord, we give you praise this morning. Thank you for your abundant grace that caused us to reign in this life. Thank you for your mercy upon us, O Lord. Thank you for loving us in spite of us. Thank you for your favor that's a shield around us. Thank you for your glory clothing. Thank you for reigning on this service and driving all the imps hindering it, Lord. Thank you for carrying us into the realm of fire and blessing. Speak to us, O Lord. Challenge us, strengthen us, fill us afresh with the Holy Ghost, that we might leave here strengthened and edified, delivered, loose, changed. Hallelujah. And Lord, we give you the glory and the praise in Jesus' name. Side, tell them I celebrate your breakthrough. Set yourself down, so now you have to stand back up. I didn't tell you to sit down. Okay, I want to read Romans 5. I'm going to be talking about something that, you know, you probably won't be excited about, but you need. Romans 5, I'll read 5 verses. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Notice, we rejoice in hope. We haven't seen it, but we keep rejoicing and expecting the glory to show up, to settle it. Amen? Hallelujah. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations. I haven't seen one yet. Look at the way they're looking at me. I'm yet to see a believer glorying in tribulations. Hallelujah. But, he says, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience, experience, and experience hope. And hope make it not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad where? In our hearts, by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Now go to James 1. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. Have you seen one of those yet? Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that give it to all men liberally, and upbraid it not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. Hallelujah. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. All right? Romans 2. Let's read them all. Therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest doest the same things. But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? Despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasurest up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds. To them who by patient continuance, patient continuance in well-doing, seek for glory and honor and immortality. They will get eternal life. But unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, what are they going to get? Indignation and wrath. Tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first, and also of the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace to every man that worketh good, to the Jew first, and also to the Gentile. For there is no respect of persons with God. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for the power of your word to heal us, to deliver us, to change us, to help us overcome sin, Satan, temptations, this life itself, and all its demons. Thank you, Father, for your glory that is upon us to settle every issue, O Lord. We celebrate your goodness and thank you for wisdom and for utterance and for blessing upon us as we share your word. Heal and deliver us, O Lord. We look to your grace to be abundant. Thank you for your faithfulness. Lord, we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Now you may be seated. On your blessed assurance. So, Ricky, I'm preaching from up here. All right. Now, I know some of you are wondering, what is this thing I want to talk about? I know I'm doing a series on the glory. We'll settle it. But I want to talk about the glory of patience. Amen. And I know we have lots of it.
Amen.
And that's why I said you're really going to love it. There are more scriptures, you know, that we will look at as time goes on. But I'm noticing that there's so much in the Word of God that we read over. Amen. And we don't pay attention to it. Amen. In other words, if I'm a woman, if I read, wife, submit yourself to your own husband. And I have 20 reasons why I cannot submit. Then I just read over that like he didn't say that. All right? Or if I know that I'm impatient, if I read about patience, then I feel like, okay, no, I can't read that part. You know? No, don't run from things you have issues with. We're learning that the grace of God will empower us to be what we are supposed to be.
Amen.
And it's the same for a man. If you have issues with your wife, he says you should love her as Christ loved the church. You are just trying to manage loving. You don't want even to start thinking about as Christ loved the church. That means you give your life. If you're mad that she didn't cook dinner, you can't be thinking about loving her as Christ loved the church. Hallelujah. You know, when I preach, I prophesy, so don't get uncomfortable. You know, the Holy Spirit searches out everything. Hallelujah.
Amen.
My point is we need to stop running from things we are not able to do naturally and reach for the grace of God to help us.
Amen.
Hallelujah. To be and to do what God wants us to do. Come on, say a stronger amen.
Amen.
Now, patience is one of those things that we don't even think is important. People are impatient. And I was saying something yesterday, you know, how driving has changed, you know, in Atlanta. And I blamed all the Westerners that came down here and the New Yorkers and everything, that they came and changed driving. But eventually it dawned on me, no, the more lustful and angrier we become, the more impatient we become.
Amen.
So I know that those people helped. Hallelujah. Because things are totally different that way. When I go to New York, it's like driving in Lagos. Hallelujah. You know, you can't drive like in your neighborhood in Atlanta. They'll run you over.
Amen.
And they'll be screaming. I told you my experience going to this shop to get, is this salami or whatever you call that? And it's a Jewish shop. Sandwich. It's huge in New York. No. Pastrami, okay. You see, I still don't know the name. What did I call it? Salami. Hallelujah. Maybe I need to invent one. And because that was my first time, I didn't know what to order. And, you know, just, I didn't wait 30 seconds. And the guy, you know, he just couldn't handle the few seconds. Sir, what can I get you? So we are all very patient, as it appears. But it's creating That's tongue-in-cheek, of course, you understand that. It's creating problems for us. And I discovered that there's something the early apostles understood that we don't understand. And the more I looked at the scriptures, the more I'm seeing over and over and over again that, I mean, when I would read it, I said, well, come on, God, help me out. What kind of grace did you give those people that they will heal somebody and then they will get arrested and then they will be whipped and they'll come out rejoicing that they were considered worthy to partake of Christ's sufferings? Our generation went in depression because we had a flat tire. And we talk about it, say, the devil has been attacking me. This has been a rough week. Oh, pray for me. So I said, what is this thing? What is this thing? And when you look at the texts we read, that's when I started discovering that it is this secret that was causing them to rejoice. Because first of all, these apostles discovered that you can't get anywhere with God except you are patient.
Amen.
Because nothing happens quickly.
Amen.
When you look over your life, you will see that you look back and say, hey, if I had just held my tongue, if I had just controlled my attitude a little bit, I would have bypassed all this chaos. If I didn't just say that one word. It's like the police pulling you over. Now you want to tell him how he was speeding. Now you bring all his demons and all that the law has given him to now unload on you. So I told you, you know, this one you just need to sit and listen. You may not shout at all. But I promise you, it will help you on your journey. Amen.
Amen.
Now, this is, I'm fascinated about it because once you understand it, it will help so many things. It will help so many things. Now watch this. He says, therefore, Romans 5, I'm beginning with the first text. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. That's where we need to begin to unravel this religion that I've been talking about. I see that we've been in. He says that the only way God will treat you like you've never sinned is that you put your faith in what Jesus did. And that's the only reason you stand before God to ask him for forgiveness or for blessing or for anything. Not because of what you're doing or not doing. That's where we begin to unravel our religion. He said we are, justification means that God treats you like you've never sinned. He said it is done, he does it by your faith. Listen, this is an entrance that revolutionizes your life. Because once you understand it, you learn to believe for change in you. Just as you believe for a car.
Amen.
Or a house.
Yeah.
Or a child.
Amen.
You believe that for the grace of God to change you.
Yeah.
To deliver you.
Yeah.
To help you.
Amen.
Become a new person.
Amen.
All right. He said to put it this way. Can you picture a situation where a man has total peace with God and God has no issue with him? What kind of blessing do you think will be coming on that man? You see? You say, ooh, we. I mean, you will just see torrents of blessing and favor.
Yeah.
Eh? Am I right?
Amen.
Come on, you're in the house.
Amen.
That's what you will tell me. But it's available to you. But your religion is rejecting it. He says you are justified by faith. In other words, if you believe in the sacrifice that the Lord Jesus did for you 2,000 years ago, and you put your faith in that for the forgiveness of your sin, for deliverance from evil habits and weaknesses in your life, he said God will treat you like you never sinned, meaning he will come and engage you and help you to overcome. I can't even get much amen. Because most of us are religious. When you do right for a few days, now you believe that you are now qualified for the blessing of God. Then when you fall back, then you live in guilt for 10 years. And every time the devil attacks you, you say, oh, it's because of that thing. Then you go for prayer again. So you keep spinning your wheels and not getting anywhere. And you wonder, well, how are all these people receiving and I'm not receiving? Because they're living under the grace of God and you're living under the law. Amen. Okay, I'm still getting to the patience, but, you know, I'm working out the text. He says that we have peace with God. Do you have peace with God? Peace with God, it says, is possible by faith. By faith. By faith. See, I'm talking about Bible. I'm not talking about what we've thought about all these years in our religion. I told you we've come to Christ and then we go back to our religion. You asked him for forgiveness by faith and he forgave you and brought you in. And then you okay, thank you, sir. And then you go back and you start practicing your religion. All right, now watch this. What was the next line? It's not coming to me. You see? He said, by whom also? You notice? You come through someone to relate to God. Not through works, but through him.
Amen.
He says,
amen.
By him we have access. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I mean, how many times have I come to the church and I see people standing outside? They're members of the church. They are faithful tithers and they're serving in the ministry. But they're standing outside. Why are they standing outside? They don't have access. I come with the key. I open the door. They all come on in.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, you can be as saved as you can be. But without faith, you have no access to everything that God has for you and for your children. Hallelujah. You must obtain them by faith. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Not by works.
Amen.
You have to believe for them.
Yeah.
Because that's a grace for every situation, for every trial. And when you are in it, you don't know how to get this grace, so you have to believe for it.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
God.
You have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand.
Amen.
Watch this. And rejoice in hope.
Hallelujah.
Of the glory. You see, when a man is believing God, after a while he starts rejoicing that the glory is coming to settle this. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. That's where that title came from. But it's taking me 3 weeks to get to the text. Or longer. He said, we rejoice in hope. Can you imagine rejoicing because you expect the glory? Hallelujah. You have to be thinking glory. Hallelujah. The permanent presence of God that works for me even when I don't work.
Yeah.
Until he frees me from my hindrances, from my weaknesses, from the things defeating me. And God gives me a breakthrough. And I get up and start praising him for a brand new life. Because we all have natural weaknesses. Some of us have shorter fuses than others. Some of us can't stop talking.
Amen.
You didn't start today. Even when you were little, your parents are beating you. Be quiet. I've never understood that with parents. They beat you, you start crying, and they tell you, be quiet. I say, you're beating him. Leave him alone. How are you going to be quiet? Shut up. I'm not beating you. Come on, you've done it. Hallelujah. All you young people, bring me your little offerings because I'm putting a good word for you. You know? Okay, now, so you have those things happening and they tell you, be quiet, and you won't stop talking, and they're beating you. That's the same thing working in you right now. You're grown, you're married, but you can never leave the argument alone. Hallelujah. Ooh. Should I have taken the offering first? All right, so you see, he says, you rejoice in hope of the glory. The hope of, you expect, in other words, God is trying to move us from self-effort to faith, to learn, to believe, for God to free me from my weaknesses by his grace. You rejoice in hope that the glory will settle this. The glory will transform me. The glory will take this from me. The glory. Hallelujah. Come on, thank him for the glory this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the glory to transform our lives, to break yokes from us, to free us from evil desires and habits. Hallelujah. Thank you for a new man coming out of us through Jesus Christ. Thank you for the miracle. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Mare sheke rabahasa. Glory to God. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Yes, you can change. Yes, you can be delivered. Yes, that evil habit will break in Jesus' name. Believe for it by the glory of God. Rejoice in hope of that glory, changing you, transforming you, making you a new man in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 Glory to God.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Bless the Lord. He said, we have access by faith into this grace. You are granted access to this God-enabling, God empowering life.
Amen.
By faith.
Yeah.
In other words, if you come any other way, you won't have access.
Amen.
You'll be just as saved as the members. You'll just be in right standing as the members. You know, you have a right to enter the building, but you don't have access. So faith will unlock the door. So you can enter into that grace. To that grace. To that grace. I'm telling you, he changes everything. So you see the devil clearly when he starts messing with you. The Bible talks about a separation between soul and spirit. That's when you discover, okay, now that's not me. Somebody's
come on now. Preach.
Somebody slipped in here.
Yeah.
I'm not usually this upset. And I'm getting some help from somewhere.
Yeah.
That's when you know. You have to renounce some things. They say, Satan, take your hands off of me in Jesus' name. I'm upset, but not this upset. No, loose me now so I don't mess up everything God has done for me. You know, when you start living by faith, you can distinguish between the flesh and the spirit.
Amen.
You say, we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Then he says, so I can get to my text because I can get comfortable before I know it, the time goes. Now watch this. He says, not only so, but we glory in tribulation. I said, well, I haven't seen anybody doing that. Now, I visited people in the hospital. You know, from experience, you know, by experience, you learn a lot of things. You know, in the early stages of sickness, You notice that when you visit people, you need to encourage them. You know, pray with them and all of that. But if they are going to go on to glory, when you visit them, they will be the one encouraging you. That's when you know that they have started sensing. Hallelujah. The realms of glory. The power of the life to come. And they will be the one cheering. There's nothing to worry about, you know. The Lord got it. And you're wondering, wow, I want to encourage them, but I left lifted by them. You see, they've tapped into something that these apostles knew. He said, we glory in tribulations also. I said, it's either you understand something I don't know or I'm missing it somewhere. I said, what is it? But he's been telling you since you got saved and reading it. But you read right over it. He said, what is making us rejoice? He said, because we know that tribulation will produce patience. That meant that they valued patience more than anything. The reason we don't... Ricky, stop talking. Okay, good. You see? Amen, amen. Ricky does this and then he says he won't come back and then he will come back again. Hallelujah. Don't worry about it. All right, now watch this. Okay, so he says, we glory in tribulations also, knowing this. You notice? That knowing is a revelation. That they understood, as you will see in all the scriptures, that this journey, remember how they started out. They thought Jesus was going to return the next week. They started selling all their things and built a commune. And all of a sudden, the journey they thought that was going to be only a few months became years. They saw many of their comrades or beloved friends, you know, murdered or killed, or, you know, Stephen and all of them. So they found out that, hey, this is not a 100-meter dash. This is a long cross-country race. And they discovered that to make it, they need patience. And they started celebrating anything that will help them become patient. You will say it over and over and over again. I mean, I could call this message the divine revelation of patience. Take whichever one you want. Amen. The glory will settle it. The glory of patience, or the divine revelation of patience. Amen. At least I'm not telling you about the divine revelation of hell. I read a book like that. I didn't finish it. It's depressing. Anyway, so he says, knowing this, that tribulation worketh patience. And patience, experience. So, if you look at your life, you see that you've gone through so many tribulations. Amen. But you didn't become more patient. Why? Because all the time you were going through, your mind was fixed on only one thing. Getting out. So, you were always in a hurry to get out. Amen. So that the tribulation ended up not benefiting you. Thank God for three honest people on this side. You see? He said that tribulation, we discovered that tribulation works patience. That meant that patience is something to be coveted. Patience is not something you run from. I've seen some people who are named patients. And I always encourage them to go look up the meaning of their name because the branding and the reality don't match. Okay? Some of you will get it tomorrow. Okay, let me help you out. They don't act like their name. Okay. All right, so, I mean, I got excited. I said, that's what they understood. Is it? Because one thing I learned through all the years of sickness and waiting on God to get to this point is how to wait. I'm never in a hurry. You've heard me say that. I got witnesses that can testify. And I know one time I told you Elder Thomas was trying to build a wall for me behind my first house. And he brought these cement blocks and sat them behind the house. They were there so long, somebody came and figured, well, hey, he's not using it. And they carried away some of it. So finally he came and built the wall, and the wall was prettier than the house. So, and he was asking me, why are you so patient? Why didn't you get upset with me? And I said, listen, he wasn't Elder Thomas then. I said, Brother Thomas, I found out in this life, it's either you have money or you have patience.
Amen.
But if you don't have money and you are not patient, God help you. You learn to wait for things. So because money will only make or exaggerate whatever you are. If you're impatient and you are given money, you will blow it. You don't know what a miracle it is that, you know, we've been on this journey for 15 years and we've never had a financial crisis. We've never come to you, ask you to give some emergency donation. We didn't get up and start calling for $1,000 line and $500 line as most churches do.
Amen.
And you just come to church, give whatever you decide to give, and go home. You don't know what a blessing that is.
Amen.
You don't even know what power that is. Those are the secrets. Because if I went out and bought everything I saw on what appears to be a deal, before long we will be in trouble.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do you know how many churches have gone under? Because somebody came to the pastor and gave him a program how he can turn the church's money over 10 times.
Yeah.
And then he put in the money and lost it all. You will discover, beloved, that a whole lot of the problems you have is because of impatience.
Amen.
That your eyes need to open this morning that we will become like these early apostles.
Yeah.
To start celebrating anything God has allowed in your life to help you become patient. Because he says you will become experienced in the things of God. And your experience will birth hope in you.
Hallelujah.
And he said this hope is so powerful that you will never be disappointed.
Amen.
In other words, God will see to it that your expectation will not fail.
Amen.
Because it was born out of experience in waiting for him.
Amen.
Glory to God. Come on, how many of you think you need this, my message? Eh? Some of you need both hands like me. He says, knowing this, that tribulation worketh patience. And patience experience. You see, when you see a man with experience, you see that he's not agitated over every little thing. You see? That's why when I see people go through bereavement, I tell them, hey, you'll be all right. Why? I've gone through it 5 times. So if I see you that you're going through one bereavement and you are, you know, you're going to camp out, you're not coming to church, you know, you see, that's okay. No. You don't. That's not how you handle it. What's talking to you? That's not the pastor. That's experience.
Yes. Amen.
I'm telling you how I have learned from God to handle these difficulties. Amen. And then you get favor out of it. Amen. All right? He said to explain further. You see, God will allow things to happen. Now he will sit back and watch your response, your attitude. That's how you gain or lose with God. They watch your responses, your professions, your attitude. They watch you in the sanctuary, see how you worship. Amen. People have all these mystic ideas about God. Amen. God made you in his image.
Yes. Amen.
The same way you correct your child and then watch their attitude. If they're pouting through the day and they come from school and they throw their... Before long, you say, boy, you better get your attitude together. Otherwise, I'm going to give it to you again. Why do you think God is any different? They watch how you respond to things. Because that's how you tell heaven and hell who your God is. Whether it is you or the devil or God the Father. There's an art to this thing. That's what I say, I kept looking for this magic thing because landing is one of the most difficult things you learn in aviation, And when I was struggling with it, I was complaining. I said, well, I wish there was better airplanes here that will have an angle of attack meter so you can just set it and just watch the wheels come in. And the old man looked at me. I said, boy, you need to learn what I'm teaching you. He said, because if there was any such thing in a more expensive airplane, say, who will give it to you to be learning?
Amen.
If you watch, how can you watch? You're not in aviation. But for airliners and all these very expensive jets, you cannot take a $110 million jet and put a neophyte in there to be bouncing it around and learning how to land. You can fold the gear and it will cost $1 million to fix.
Amen.
All right, so they'll put you in the simulator. Now you can crash it all you want to. They'll just send the technician to recalibrate it. So he was telling me that if there was such an expensive airplane, you wouldn't be flying it.
Amen.
So you need to learn it. So you learn to feel for it. He kept telling me, you need to find the horizon. And you put the nose of the plane on the horizon, and you see, you have to feel for it, and you have to continue to put back pressure, meaning pulling the yoke back a little bit, to hold it, until the wheels come in. In other words, you have to be patient with it.
Amen.
See, now that some of you finally got what I'm telling you. Once you come through the wrong way, and you are not patient, what do you get? And sometimes, some of these airline pilots have landed. I said, man, if I had hit it like that, I wouldn't come out to stand and watch you all leave. I would be hiding in the cockpit. But this, I guess, is the requirement from the job. They will come and stand there. And I would just look at him and say, well, hey, may the Lord help you. Patience, beloved. Everything in this life, anything worth having, takes time. Anything. He said, we glory in tribulation. So what's the revolution that must happen in your life? That from this morning, the next time you get in a fight, you start celebrating, thank you, Lord, that I'm going to be more patient.
Amen.
When I come through this. Since everything that will happen in this kingdom happens,
amen,
patiently. Patiently. I'm going to show you more scriptures. Now, let me go to James. He says, James the servant of our Lord Jesus Christ and God the Father, to the strangers scattered abroad. Then he named all those places, Cappadocia and some of them, Bithynia. Then he says, Then elect according, no, not another one. That's Peter that I'm quoting. My brethren, he says, count it all joy when. Now you notice, not if you fall. So it's only a matter of time. You're going to be going through something. When you fall into diverse temptations. Knowing this. You notice they keep using the word knowing. What do we know? Why are they telling us to count it all joy? He says that the trying of our faith worketh. You see, they all understood it. It is us that don't understand. He said, that's why they've been rejoicing. I said, well, why do they value patience so much? You see, they learned something from our God. That this is how, you see, because you know, the more comforts we have, the more easily irritated we become. But if you lived in that time, you didn't even know whether you will survive next week. You may get murdered. You may get martyred. You may be stoned. So they put on the garment of patience. I'm telling you. You know, when you live in a country where you have so many comforts, it makes you so impatient. I told you, even the microwave is taking too long.
Amen.
And before long, somebody will invent something where you can put your food in for 30 seconds. And then we all rush over there. You see? And almost every few months, somebody invents something else. I heard them the other day talking about some new thing that is air frying your food. How can you air fry your food? So you have all these conveniences. Now, don't stone me. But, you know, most of, you know, Africans or Nigerians or, particularly Nigerians, let me put it that way, that marry African Americans, if they try to move back there, or you're getting quiet, really. 6 months, the sister is back.
Amen.
I'm telling you.
Amen.
She said, I'm going back. First of all, there's no light. Do you understand that? But in America, if there's no light, it's news. The news will start, you know, breaking news. Oh, Lord. I saw one guy on WhatsApp, and I was wondering, who posted this thing here? So I clicked play. He said, can you believe it? It's been a week, and my light hasn't gone off. What's going on? That must be a trick to this. He says, I don't want to get a bill that I can't pay. You see, because you may have light only 3 days out of the month and you still get a bill. That's when you learn patience. You see, because in America, you can call Georgia Power and tell them a thing or two or go over there. That place, there will be the number will work. And when you get to the office, there will be nobody to talk to. They say, what is the problem? He said, your light is not on. They say, so? You learn to be patient. Hallelujah. It's the conveniences of America that has ruined all of us.
Amen.
He says, knowing this. He said, count it all joy. When you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. And he said something amazing. He said, let patience have her. Okay, now. Why would it call patience a woman? Okay, I'll leave it there. He said, let patience have her perfect. He said, in other words, take your life and leave it in the hands of patience. He said, when she gets through with you, oh, Lord, the way that sounded. Pray for me, you know, pray for me. Okay. Come on, you guys are here to defend me. Be praying in tongues while I'm. I gotta go home, eh? Well, she's laughing too. All right, now he says, let patience have her perfect work. He said, patience does a thorough job, a complete work, so that you will be perfect.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There's no way to be perfect in a hurry. So God knows what you need. Stop agitating. Stop hurrying to nowhere.
Amen.
You need it. If you have been married for any length of time, there's one major discovery that comes to you. People don't change in a hurry.
Amen.
People change slowly.
Amen.
You see, look, all the married people, before I finish, all their mouths went that way. There's no microwave version. You need it more than you recognize.
Amen.
Because all the plans of God keep being aborted by impatient believers.
Yeah.
That's what I'm telling you, particularly people that are called to the ministry. They will not settle down somewhere, serve God, and patiently wait for his time.
Amen.
They keep looking for a place they can walk right in the door. And then they put you in position. You don't know that anything that works like that is magic.
Come on, preach. Amen.
If you can walk right through the door and the person don't know you from Adam, you haven't sown anything, you haven't labored, and they just put you in leadership, you watch that ministry. It won't take long and it scatters. Because you haven't suffered for it. You haven't paid. You don't even understand the anointing and the grace that governs it. You have to learn his ways, how God works with it. And so they bounce from place to place to place until finally 20 years has gone by.
Amen.
And you still don't have any, nothing, because you don't know the ways of God. And I was telling them that when I came from India to America, that was the first time I've ever followed anything. That's a lesson in itself. To just sit there and watch people struggling with things that you can tell them with your eyes closed what to do, but you can't say anything. If you say anything, war breaks out. Because the war is, okay, you're trying to say you are better or no better. You know, you start a war. And you have to sit there and watch it. Okay? Then as if that wasn't enough, God knew all my issues. So he went and put me in the music ministry where I would just play the guitar. And he took these two guys, smoking reefer, to be over me. You see? He said, ah! That's the way God does it.
Amen.
He said, let patience You know what sandpaper is?
Yes.
Have you seen, you know, now they have more modern instruments that will help you finish wood quicker. But in the olden days, you know, that's patience, having her perfect work. And they just keep working on you, working on you, working on you, until you stop being upset about the thing. And then finally, and then you break and you just turn it over to the Lord. And then somebody looks at you and they say, well, you know, he's just rejoicing because he don't have any problems. You're right. It's because he's going through his own.
Yeah.
And you don't want to go through yours.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on, look, see this mystery. He says, let patience have her perfect work. I mean, people say, well, I'm perfect. Now, you know you're not perfect, you know. But, you know, you say that jokingly. But this is how you become perfect. It's only when patience finishes with you. You say you'll be perfect and entire, meaning finished. You say you'll be lacking nothing. No, you didn't hear what I said. You say you'll be lacking. That means that while you are waiting on God, that's even an art in itself. Because that's when you learn the art of personal worship. When you are hurting and you worship God anyway and say, Lord, I'm hurting. I don't know what you're waiting on, but I trust you. You know, you go through those times. He said, so many things are fed into you. You don't even know when they were worked in. But when you graduate, you see that you have a strength. You don't know where you got it from. You have power. You have wisdom. You have staying grace. You are no longer a fly by night. You can take a licking and keep on taking. Hallelujah. Hey, I'm telling you, I can feel my water stirring, beloved. You know how to abase. You know how to abound. You can be on top. You can be beneath. But wherever you are, you have faith in God. Hallelujah. That's the mystery of this thing. He said, you will be perfect and entire, lacking nothing. Wow. You will lack nothing. Can you believe that? It's over and over and over. Now, where's my thing? Look at Hebrews. I may not have time to read the whole thing. Okay. I will still come back to James because he just showed me that I didn't finish it. Hebrews 6. I'll come back to James. For God, verse 10, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work. And? If you are not patient, you don't believe that. As soon as you are not getting any recognition for what you're doing, you cut out. But when you've been cooked, when patience has had its work, things have been worked into you. What is worked into you? Faith, trust. You will come to this. You will know that God is not unrighteous. He knows what you're doing. He will never. Glory to God. He said he will never forget. Never. He will never forget. I told you in those days, this guy came to me and said, you know, the pastor told me to let you teach adults on the school. We used to have two services and adults in the school in between. I said, okay. And I'm wondering. I said, when did he tell you this? He said, a year ago. Okay. It took 1 year for him to tell me that the pastor told him. He said, now, this is how God will check you out. He said, now, but before I'll do it, I'm ready to do it. Before I'll do it, I want to try this other guy out first. Let me see how he does first. Then I'll try you. I said, okay. But you see, when God has gotten through to you, you know that that's the way.
Yeah.
And periodically, he will have somebody say something or do something. And they watch to see that thing, if it will stir back up. What do you mean you will? They say, okay, add 6 months to it. He's not ready yet. I said, okay, you can try him. I just went on by my business. But you see, I'm only looking at these things in hindsight. But I didn't know when those things were worked in. It was all the sufferings of the past. If I talk about my folks, now they will wait for me at home, you know. Okay. See, because when somebody has paid all the bills and all this, and then when they tell you anything, well, I quit. You say, well, I quit just because you know I'm paid. If you were paying, if they mess with you, you swallow your pride and say, yes, sir. You see, God worked all these things, and he's still working it, because you never get a certificate. You see? Look at how long we've been waiting for the promises of God to be made manifest.
Amen.
Uh-huh. So eventually, when somebody comes and sees thousands of people or sees all the outreaches and all this stuff, they say, well, how did you get it done? They're waiting for you to give them 4 steps.
Yeah.
So they can go and put it in motion. And then it just happens. I say, get a life.
Amen.
Lay hands on me so I can receive it. Yeah, right. Who laid hands on me? You know? And then so that Sunday, we all came and the guy started. You have 45, 50 minutes for Bible study. 50 minutes later, he ran out of gas. He said, well, I'm sorry, that's all I have. I said, amen. So he came to me immediately and said, well, we can see that this guy can't do it, so maybe we'll try you next Sunday. In the flesh, that would have gotten to me. He kept using the word, try, try, try. We'll try. You see, I mean, naturally, I would have told him, man, I started preaching before you got saved. Sit down. Then he would scratch me off and go and tell the pastor what I said. And they will agree, don't let him teach. That's what I'm saying. If you would just look back, you see there's so many things. If you had held your tongue, your blessing would have flowed. If you had managed your attitude better and been a little more patient. I mean, we had an experience here because we're dealing with homeless people and people in need all the time. You have to be patient.
Amen.
You see? Because many times they come when it's not convenient.
Amen.
Yes, you know, you're tired or whatever, you know. So an Elder Bobby bears the brunt of most of it. The police will bring people here constantly. Even on Mondays when I'm playing ping pong, they come knocking on the door. I said, you know, you feel like, can I just get one day, you know? So one evening during the fast, Elder Bobby came to me, and it was like, you know, there's something in me. You have to know it. For those that are around me, they understand what I'm talking about. You see, while he was on the way, I saw him walking up to me. That thing ignited. It was like an offense, like, I said, Elder Bobby, I don't know what you're trying to say, but no. See, most of you can't handle it.
Amen.
Then if you can't handle it, then you'll be at the door. You lose your ministry.
Amen.
So he said, okay, there's this couple over there, you know, that all they need is just transport money to go back to Virginia. They just want to go back because nothing is working. I said, no. So I came back in the sanctuary and I'm asking myself, Why did I say no? I said, okay, Lord, I don't want to get myself in trouble. So I knelt down. I said, Lord, why did I say no? He said, because their breakthrough is 24 hours away. If you give them the transport money, they will miss their breakthrough tomorrow. Hey! I said, thank you, Jesus. You need patience. See, I have so many scriptures. I hope I can get it in. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. You notice your work and
labor.
You notice, remember that work was there before man fell. But after man sinned, labor entered. What is that telling you? Your work are the things you do under the anointing. Your labor of love are things you do when it's hard.
Yeah.
You need faith to do it.
Amen.
Labor of love.
Yeah. Amen.
The love of Christ is forcing me to do this. I don't want to do it. It's not convenient.
Amen.
I'm telling you, God wants to produce real believers in this house.
Amen.
That's why I'm teaching these things lately.
Amen.
Now watch this. He says, God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed towards his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. You've ministered to the saints and do minister. In other words, you didn't quit.
Amen.
You're not a has-been.
Yeah. Come on now.
You started. But you are still.
Amen.
You minister to the saints and do minister. And we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence. You notice? The same diligence. Not every now and then. You stay with it.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
That's what I keep telling the youth ministry. I said, I'm going to come to youth ministry for a month. When I get ready and talk to you guys about a lot of things. He said, because when you are young, you are zealous.
Yeah.
But you don't have wisdom.
Amen.
You don't understand the ways of God. You want to change the world for God. But you can't run the race set before you.
Amen. Amen.
I'm telling our young folks, they're going out, they're feeding the hungry and doing all this stuff. I said, don't you see that God brought ministry to you over here? You got all these young men been playing basketball here for years.
Amen.
Why aren't you all doing the bridge over there? Amen. Go and find out how tough it is.
Amen.
Then your head will quickly come down.
Amen.
But you know, but when you see something already prayed out, then you run over there. But when you go and size yours up, man. You get in your car and drive somewhere else. But the bridge is waiting on you behind the house.
Amen. Amen.
I was sitting in the car and I saw two young men with the basketball walking past me. And the Lord said to me, I send them to you. So what are you all doing? There's no, you know, ministry. There's no nothing. You say, well, we went out there one time and they didn't. That's what I'm telling you. You go out there one time, they didn't act right. So your patience is. I need binoculars. No, not binoculars.
Microscope.
To see this patience. See now, but if somebody else goes out there and goes through the insults and patiently works with them and finally wins them over and he starts thriving, here comes all those that feel called to the youth ministry. You know, all right, you know, this is my call. Sit down. You see? Somebody was asking me some years ago, so why do you honor your leaders? I said, because they were the ones that served God with me. When you were not around.
Amen.
They were the ones that believed in me. They were the ones that helped me clean up this this mold-infested building.
Amen.
Elder Thomas washed seats for a whole year.
Amen.
And so when I roll out the red carpet for them, you understand what I'm doing. I can't forget those that helped me come over.
Amen.
I celebrate them. I celebrate their birthdays. I honor them.
Amen. Amen.
That's the way God is.
Hallelujah.
One guy came in here. He said he played drums for Prince and all of that stuff. I said, okay, I know you're gifted, but that one is my son. He's been hanging in here for years, so I can't just let you push him out.
Amen.
Because you played for Prince. He got mad and left. I said, good.
Amen.
Because when you were not here, he was here playing.
Amen.
That's the way God is.
Yeah.
You see? So many people want to preach the gospel. They want to save the world. But it's only after it's all set up.
Yeah.
I saw a movie once, and this guy was dreaming about his call to the ministry. And the place was packed out with thousands. And then the music played, and they announced him coming in. And he walked in, and people were cheering. And then he woke up and he was so excited. And then he started this ministry and he thought that, you know, all he dreamed was going to just manifest in a hurry, you remember?
Yeah.
And he wasn't seeing anything. He put out his flyers, and then only one person showed up. So, okay, maybe next week, and more people will show up. Only one person showed up. This time it was a different one person. That meant that you didn't even convince the one that came last week. You see, it's only when you have suffered and been through things. That's why I said that people that don't honor people that have done things. You see, you are telling me you haven't done anything. Because when you've done something, you know how tough it is.
Amen.
How difficult it is. How slow it is. You know, it's like seeing somebody else's children and they turn out right and they're doing great. And then you go blasting yours. All right, they labored with theirs.
Yes. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
My God, I didn't get any amen. It got so quiet on that one. Okay, now watch this. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed toward his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister, and we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope. Full assurance. Remember, he said, faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things. He said, this is a full assurance. The Bible speaks about full assurance of faith. But this one says the full assurance of hope. Diligence,
yeah.
Patiently.
Yeah.
Watch this. That's why I came for this scripture. That you be not slothful.
Hallelujah.
So what is the underlying source of impatience? Laziness. Because when you look at the rigor of the right process, it's too long. It's too difficult. You need microwave. Press three buttons. I saw this preacher on television. He said, he used to preach 7 steps to your breakthrough, 9 steps to your miracle, 5 steps to your wondrous life. He said, after a while, he went through such pain and difficulty. He went to the bookstore and threw away all them books. He said, what 7 steps? There's no 7 steps. There's not even any, no 20 steps. You don't know what the steps are.
Amen.
until you get in.
Yeah.
Is it? But that's what people want. If I put out a book, 7 Steps to a Breakthrough Debt-Free Ministry, ooh, it will sell like hotcake. Even people that don't have a ministry will be buying it to prepare themselves. I wish it worked like that. I told you about the God of reincarnation. Said the guy came to him. Of course, we don't believe in that, but it's just for illustration. He said he went to the God of reincarnation. He said, now, this time when you send me back, I want to be handsome. I want to be rich. I don't want any sickness. I want the most beautiful wife. I want to live in the best neighborhoods. He just went on and on and on and on. He said that when he finished, the God of reincarnation said, wait a minute. If he did it this good, I won't send you. I will go myself. I mean, if you can get it all done. Hallelujah. So, hey, come on now. I want you to see this punchline. This might be where I will leave it so we can finish the service on time. And I will finish next Sunday. Watch this. Don't skip church next Sunday. You know?
Amen.
All right. He says, and we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end, that you be not slothful, but followers of them. Who? And you notice, inherit. What is it telling you? Whatever you think God has promised you, it will take patience to manifest it.
Yeah.
And he says you need to follow them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. But what is the problem we have in church? People are not following anybody. They're following God. No, God sets you in a ministry and puts a group of people in front of you. He said, now follow them. Watch them. Pattern after what they're doing.
Amen.
So you can enter into your promise.
Amen.
You see, you don't see us, you know, when you don't feel like it's over, like, I won't go this week. I just go next week. Nobody's modeling that for you.
Amen.
So you're following yourself.
Amen.
We don't tithe when we have money.
Amen.
We put God first.
Amen.
We started that years ago.
Amen.
Right? So, I mean, you can just go through the covenants. I mean, we're not perfect. When we miss it, we make quick corrections. And God said, you follow them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Hallelujah. You notice you inherit the promise. Okay. You see, the Holy Spirit does not miss words. You inherit the promises. You notice a promise materializing in your life, he's telling you, it's a world you enter into. You notice when fathers die, they leave an inheritance.
Amen.
To the children. They come into wealth they didn't have.
Amen.
They come into property. They come into the will.
Yes.
You inherit the promise.
Amen.
With all the privileges.
Yes. Amen.
You see? It, that's the way it works. Through faith and patience. That's why you ought to celebrate your next trial.
Amen.
And thank God that this is producing patience in your life.
Amen.
Celebrate patience.
Yeah.
You will get your breakthrough.
Amen.
Celebrate patience. The promises of God will manifest. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Celebrate patience. Hallelujah.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
And it shall be as the Lord has spoken. Come on, give him praise. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God. So, you ought to disciple yourself this morning and tell yourself there's no need to be depressed. There's no need to wonder whether God is coming. There's none of that. Follow those before you, who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Hallelujah. Now, but if you were impatient at 25 and you are still impatient at 65, you've missed the entire journey and you've missed so many breakthroughs along the way because so many things God would have done, you aborted.
Amen.
Because you jumped the gun, you quit before time. I told you that my brother published a book. He paid for the book to be published. And we ordered some copies from the publisher. And after 1 year of sales, when the reconciliations were being done, the amount of books they reported as sold was even below what we ordered from them. That told you that that book was very cooked. It was pressure cooker cooked. All right, so, and my brother in anger, you know, canceled the contract. And later on, he started praying to the Lord, asking the Lord for a breakthrough with the books. And God said, who told you to cancel that contract? And then he, you know, gave the Lord all his reasons, you know, they're cheating, blah, blah, blah. And the Lord said that this company had been cheating people all these years and that he had been waiting for a righteous man to judge them by. He said, and you were my man, but you cut me off before I could get it done. Those books are still sitting there unsold today. Do you understand what I'm telling you? You can be impatient. You see, these leaders will tell you that I don't make decisions. They are made for me.
Amen.
And when I don't know what to do, I just don't do anything.
Amen.
I just wait.
Amen.
I don't care how much pressure you put on me. But the day they tell me what to do, I just act on it.
Amen.
So when I keep hanging around a decision, God is not saying anything, and finally I say, okay, it must be that he don't want to do it. Because I've never known God to be somebody you have to force.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is a flow.
Yes.
You see? You don't get into, you know, manipulating, you know, and trying to make him do this. I know when we hear about importunity, we think that importunity means that you're trying to make God do something. No. Importunity is for personal transformation. See how you're looking at me? Okay, I'll show it to you. Even though I got 28 minutes and I need to give communion and receive offering and all of that. But look at Luke 18. Let me show it to you. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint, saying, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. This is where most of the church have gone off track on this text. Can I help you understand something? You can wear God out.
Amen.
God is not the unjust judge. They were using an unjust judge to give an illustration.
Yeah.
All right? That's the first thing I want you to understand. Number two, let's read. It says, and the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge saith. So first of all, is your heavenly Father unjust?
No.
No. God is a just judge. So he doesn't act like the unjust judge.
Amen.
Okay. Now watch this. Number two. Or number three. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he... He says he bears long with us.
Amen.
What is the issue? That's why I told you importunity is not to pressure God. Importunity is to transform you. He said he puts up with you a long time.
Yeah.
You are hounding him to do this thing. But he's putting up with your irritation.
Yeah.
Hounding him, waiting on you to understand what the issue is.
Amen.
He bears long with you. But if you don't understand it, you think that you are persevering in prayer to make God. That's why I don't teach people that your persistence in prayer is for personal transformation and for you to come to understanding and revelation.
Yeah.
And you naturally flow into what God has for you.
Yeah.
And then he does the work in you and for you, and then you manage what he's doing. Question you ought to ask yourself, why you are hounding him, Lord? Did I understand? I know we said we will do marriage and family, and I don't see her here this morning, but I talked to Minister Art's wife, who is a marriage and family therapist, certified therapist. So we said we'll talk about love languages, and and then she was telling me that she wanted to talk about people planning to get married. He said, and she made one statement that was so profound to me. He said that people are so busy planning a wedding, but not preparing to be married.
Amen.
He said that what you should do during your courtship is preparing to be married. Get yourself organized. No. What? How many dishes can you cook? There are only three meats out there. Chicken, beef, pork, fish, shrimp. Okay, by the time the health people finish with you, you lose pork, you lose beef, and then if shrimp is questionable. So you have only fish and chicken. So you better know how to cook fish. Otherwise, they send you back to your parents. In other words, you need to prepare yourself. You know, learn how to clean up.
Amen.
Get organized.
Amen.
I keep asking you, why would you be late to church and you just have yourself alone? All you have to, you are not preparing to preach or minister. All you have to do is get up, take a shower, put something on, and be on time. And you come at 8:30 and you're praying to be married.
Amen.
God said, well, how will I put you to run a house? You can't even run yourself.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And all the single ladies said, the rest of them refused. Because when you are married, you have to get up early. You have to plan your Sunday dinner. Hallelujah. At least that's the way it used to be. I don't know what y'all are doing.
Amen.
You should get your Sunday dinner. You get up early, get all that done. You have planned your clothing and all of that. So you she's saying cook on Saturday. All right. So you get up, you know, get dressed. You come to church. And when church is over, you leave immediately and get all the food going. And when people come in, the food is ready.
Amen.
They'll be singing your praise.
Amen.
But when you come in with, I was going to say something. I said, that's too close to home, you know. No, she's been doing a great job, really. Hallelujah. Now, But, you know, I was going to say Popeyes, and I said, okay, no, she comes in with Popeyes chicken sometimes. So that's too close to home. But, you know, you come in with Publix. Because that's where y'all go get your dinner. Publix and this, you know, all these veggies, you know, we got all these preservatives. And then one day somebody gets sick and says, well, how did that happen? Hallelujah. We'll be looking at the cook. he says, let me read it to you again. And the Lord said, verse 6, hear what the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long? So how long has the Lord been putting up with you? And you keep thinking that this thing you are asking him is the issue. No, it's what you have refused to get. He's waiting on you to get the lesson. He's waiting on you to change. Amen. To learn what he's teaching you and be transformed. And now you can get what it is. Because if he gives you something and then you tear it up with your shenanigans, then what's the use for all the years you waited? All right, I'll read it to you again. In case you want to know the meaning of bear, I have two King James programs, and I'm clicking on bear. It's not opening up the Strong's definition. All right, but I know that bear means put up with, you know, endure, bear, you know, all of that. All right? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. In other words, the moment you get the message, boom, here he comes. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? He said, when I come, will I still find you believing?
Amen.
So when he's telling you should persevere in prayer, you should not think, get this erroneous idea that the Lord is the unjust judge, you have to make him. Even Jesus tells you, don't use vain repetitions. So that's irritating. He said, that's what the heathen do. They think that they shall be heard for their much speaking.
Yeah.
He said, but your heavenly Father knows what things you have need of before you ask.
Yeah.
So let us love our heavenly Father with all our hearts, with all our minds, with all our strength. And that his glory will continue to rest on us. His favor will be upon us and our children and our families, and he will fight the enemy for us and defeat him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He said the glory will raise a standard. Hallelujah. When the enemy comes in, the Lord will raise a standard.
Amen.
Glory to God. Come on, join me and love on him. Join me and worship him. Hallelujah. No matter where you are, whatever your issues are, whatever your frustrations are, whatever your delays may be, just love on him. Thank him for loving you. Thank him for putting up with you. Thank him. Love on him. Worship him. Hallelujah. He will perfect all that concerns us. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you. Thank you for touching the people this morning. Thank you for correcting them lovingly. Thank you for building their hearts back up, their faith back up. Thank you for helping them understand their need for patience. That, Lord, they will not think that their trial is unnecessary. Any challenge is unnecessary. That's all part of the work you're doing in us. You said, let patience have a perfect work, that we may be perfect and entire, lacking nothing. We celebrate you. We celebrate you. Help us to conclude this message next Sunday. And we dig into the issues of wisdom and all the other things you want to talk about. Oh, we celebrate you. Thank you for resurrection here this morning. Thank you for turning dead hopes, dead dreams, turning them around and quickening and making things come alive. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I just feel the love of God in the atmosphere. Hallelujah. If you would just let him, he will touch you. He will cause those dead things to come alive. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We give you praise. We give you praise. You know, sometimes due to lack of understanding, some of us get angry and we stop reading our word and all those kinds of things. You're not reading your word for God. You're reading it for yourself. You're praying to edify yourself, to strengthen yourself so you have wisdom. I'm telling you this morning, surrender your life. If you need to rededicate your life to the Lord, you can do that. As we conclude the service, you come to the altar. One of the leaders will minister with you and pray with you, and the Lord will answer. For he's faithful that promised. He's faithful that promised. The Lord is a good God. He's a faithful God. He will not withhold any good thing from them that walk uprightly. Hallelujah. But exercise your faith in him this morning. If you're struggling with anything, believe him for deliverance. Use your faith. Believe him for grace to overcome that thing. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Allow him to develop you in patience in your relationships. Whether that be business or home or wherever, learn that patience is the way. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord,